Here we go, finally. Okay guys, I was looking forward to this one actually. You know, I just thought for a change, let's do something not too complicated, but can also be a lot of fun because we can use the salts here, especially with this bottom section. That's why I played around a bit on the, you know, on the, it was a PS Express, you know, where I just experimented with putting some filters and that over it as well, just to make it more interesting color-wise, you know, because those colors were a bit sort of boring in the initial one, even with the red pots and stuff like that, so yeah. And then I didn't obviously stick to it exactly the same. I mean, this is not the exact same ratio as the one in the photograph. I drew it the way I thought it fitted nicely on my piece of paper, basically, you know. So I just changed it slightly size-wise. And then I just like three, you know, in a painting. So instead, I like the two pots, but I thought let's make it three pots and add some more flowers or something to it. So those are made up plants, okay. That I made them up out of my head. I didn't try and copy something, okay. So but I thought what we could do is we can start off with the pen and ink this time round, and we can sort of get the sketching going, get a nice sort of feel for the just for the pen and ink. I don't want to put the watercolor down first, so let's just do the pen and ink first and then we can add the watercolor onto it afterwards, you know. All right, so what I'm going to do is with the plants, I'm just going to get rid of some of the pencil because I used quite a, it was a no-name brand, so it didn't actually say whether it was an HB or whatever. But just be very careful when you're doing the erasing, don't rub. I always find somehow it just messes up the paper. It doesn't matter how good your paper is, but if you have a hard rubber and you erase quite hard, I've noticed that actually where it's erased, where you've done the erasing, even if it's good paper, it tends to have a weird sort of texture when you're painting it. It definitely affects the paper. So I've been trying to rather just use the kneadable eraser and actually just dab it on, you know, like that. Just to sort of lift some of the pencil, you know, instead of rubbing the paper. Look, it does depend on your paper, obviously. Okay. All right, cool. So I've done my little editing thing there, and I'm going to start off with the pots because they are sort of the most, well, not the most important, well, they are, I suppose, the important part, yeah, but yeah, the whole thing is important, but my pots are basically, and because I've made them up as well, then I'm not going to worry too much about what I see in front of me here. Just with regards to when we're actually painting, you know, you'll see there's going to be a bit of a shadow cast at the back behind the pots. You'll see if you look carefully at the reference, you'll see how the shadows have been cast at the back because it hasn't got very direct sunlight. It's more, you can almost see that it's an overcast day because the shadows are soft, you know. I don't know if you've noticed when you look at shadows, overcast days your shadows will be soft, and on a harsh sunny day your shadows will have a much harder edge to them, you know. They're not so, they sort of not as diffused. Okay, so cool. So I'm going to stick with my, I'm just going to use my 0-1. So I'm going to start getting my little pot in there, and just with a broken line. And then you can add some texture to your pot as you see fit as well to it. But I'm just going to basically do pots. I'm going to sort of get the pots finished and get them out of the way, because they are going to be one of the main parts of this whole thing. So I think I'm going to rather stick with getting them done, and then I don't have to worry about finishing them off later on, because they'll actually be already done. I really don't know what flower this is. It's just a made up little flower. You can perhaps put two flowers if you want to, but that's entirely up to you. Okay, if you want to, you can put a pattern on your pots as well. You know what I mean? So if you want to, sort of one of those pots to put a nice pattern on it, you can do that too. It's also quite cool. Just try and make sure that your pot's quite symmetrical though. Don't make it skew as if somebody's thrown it skewed. Do you know what I mean? So try and keep that as symmetrical as possible. Otherwise, it's going to keep on bothering you, that, you know. Because it's one thing you'll always notice with pots and any cups or bowls or anything like that, if they're skewed, you're going to notice it immediately, you know. And then also your little plate at the bottom that it's sitting on, remember that'll sort of go, because I don't know if you noticed, but the way that we're looking at this, a parrot has decided his bird, I can't remember what bird that is now. We play these things to him on the bird app, so he loves to copy them all. There's a Pip May Fro. Oh, it's so funny. Yeah, he goes through this whole repertoire of all the birds that we've taught him, you know, so. He thinks he's very clever now. He's a what are those birds? A rain bird. Yeah, so you'll see the angle. You've noticed the bottom. I don't know if you noticed, but the bottom ledge is not as so much of an angle as the top ledge. So that means that you're actually looking at it from a lower section, you know, a lower view. Thank you. cashews wouldn't really grow in a pot, but anyway, it's a bit of a misnomer that, but it's fine. I'm just thinking, no, they wouldn't actually grow out of a pot, but it's fine. Oh goodness, that'd be a little bit top heavy, you know, so, okay. Yeah, so I think that's quite nice. Yeah, I'm going to give some of my pots a bit of an edge. You know, so maybe decorate your pots a little bit as well, just so, you know, that you can... just give them some interest as well. I mean, you are going to colour them too, but it'll be quite nice to give them maybe a bit of a pattern, or you can have a zigzag perhaps. That could be quite nice. I'm just going along as I feel. Yeah, that actually looks quite cool. I'm gonna have this little zigzag pattern on mine. And then it sort of varies the pots as well, because my shapes are very similar. So just by varying it slightly, then you know, then I can actually... Okay, I wouldn't actually see as much of the top there. So I made a little bit of a boo-boo there. So I'm just going to give that more of an edge. Because remember, I still said we're looking from further down, so you wouldn't actually see the inside of the pot. That's better. Okay, then I'm just going to, actually maybe I just wait for my pen to dry a bit. And then I'm just going to work on the woody part of this thing. Okay. So there I want to definitely add some textures. I'm going to try and keep the doors relatively plain. Just so that these pots can stand out against them, you know what I mean? So if you keep the doors plain, then the pots will really pop, and then we can add the textures to the wood and this lovely sort of wall around at the bottom over here as well. And I think that will actually work quite well. I think that's what appealed to me, was the simplicity of these doors with the two bright sort of pots, and then this lovely texture around it as well, which gives it something interesting. So here you can either follow the picture if you want to. I mean, you know, you can follow what you actually see here, or otherwise you can make up your own thing. I did use rulers and measurements just to make sure that this was straight, because otherwise you'll notice it'll definitely look a bit skew, you know, if you try and do it freehand. And also because I'm working on such a large piece of paper, there wasn't any point in trying to even be brave and stupid. And try and do it freehand, you know, so yeah. But everything I'm going to do with a relatively broken line, no solid lines as usual, because it is a rough sort of surface. The wood itself is old and rugged. So. You can obviously use rulers if you want to at some stage, you know, if you want to get some straight lines on there. I did try and get the perspective lines correct, so that was a big thing. I did make sure that those were sort of relatively accurate, because that's the first thing you'll notice if you're looking at a picture like this. It's got very specific perspective lines, you know, that you, if you have them if they're a bit skew or they're just not right, and you're going to notice immediately, and your eye will pick it up immediately, because you know we live in houses, and you know there's always buildings around us, so we have almost like a natural sense of when perspective is wrong. When you look at a painting or a picture, you'll see, oh crap, that's definitely not right, you know. So when I was looking at my drawing, I was just making sure that that was right. It's very important that make sure your perspective lines are right. I'm sort of just sort of doing mostly the outlines at the moment, just to sort of get my bearings. Especially where you've got these nice little broken surfaces. I must be honest with the travel sketching. Sorry. Yeah, with the travel sketching, it has loosened up my drawing quite a lot, you know, because I'm trying to capture something relatively quickly. Look, it is from my photographs that I've taken, but I was trying to imagine that I only had a certain amount of time to do it in, you know, and by sort of limiting yourself time-wise, then, you know, you become quicker and quicker at sort of capturing the essence of something. You know, and I love the travel sketching. Yeah, so for the travel sketching, I basically use pen and ink. So I always sketch out first with pen and ink, and then I'll go and fill in a little bit of colour with the thing. But I don't know if you saw the recent one I did. Did you see it or not, Vanessa? Let me get the book quickly, and I'll show you. Yeah, so, you know, so basically here, if you can look here, yeah, I think that one you probably saw. So all of these I start off just with pen and ink. So just pen and ink on its own, you know, and then these are other ones that I did as well. And I'll show you, let me just show you. So that was the latest one I did now. That was last, yeah. So there you can see it's all pen and ink. So I start off like this. Here's one that I've started off with now. I started off yesterday and I just never got around to it. So I start off with a pen and ink sketch, and I try and do it freehand if I can, you know. When it comes to buildings and stuff like that, you just got to make sure your perspective is right, but that you can just use your pen to actually look at the building, and then you can sort of judge an angle and all that, you know. So you can use that as a reference. Yeah, and then I basically do as much pen and ink as I want in the picture, and then I basically just use the watercolour just to add a bit of colour to it. You know, I could just, some of the pen and ink sketches I look at and I think, oh, they're actually quite nice on their own. But like this one, you'll see, it would have been too much if I'd filled in everything with watercolour. You know, it's not meant to be a finished painting, as in like something that you can hang on your wall type of thing, you know. It's supposed to be quite sort of quick. So you're trying to capture the essence of the thing that you're busy drawing. So here it was this window with the green and that sort of thing. And then it gives you an idea that it's surrounded by bricks, but it's in, you just put basic little sketches in, you know. Whereas others, like the door as well, that I did have a lot more colour over here, and then it just took away from the door. And the door is actually what I was trying to capture. So for me, it's very much about, like, this is more of a scene, and then the scene, there's, okay, so there it was about the rock sort of, but then also a little bit of the scenery, you know. So you sort of got to figure out what's important in the picture, you know, like here's the proteas, you know, it was about the proteas and the chimney type of thing. So I didn't put in everything that was there, I just sort of put the basics. That's about the tree and the rocks, yeah. So that's what travel sketching is about, and it's supposed to be quite quick, you know, it's not supposed to be a long process. So yeah, you should be able to do it, you know, in about half an hour or so, maybe 45 minutes, you know. It depends on what size you're doing. This is quite a nice size, I must be honest. You get tiny little ones as well, but I don't like the very small ones. Those are just, it's too much, you know, so. Like when you look at it, you know, don't like get sort of carried away in the smaller things as well. Just be careful that you don't go overboard in certain areas and that you detract from the rest of your picture. Just be careful what you put in, like around the flowers and that. Okay, your colour is obviously going to also make a big difference to the picture as well. Thank you. Over here has got a slightly different texture to the side, so I'm going to make sure I bring that in, you know what I mean? So you'll see, you know, the side one has got sort of more liney type things, and then this has almost got like chipped paint, you know, which I quite like. So I'm going to stick, look, putting that color on top also made a big difference. I mean, if you compare it to the original picture doesn't have quite so much interest in it, you know. So I don't know which one you guys are copying, if you're copying the yellow one or involved in this one. I'm actually going to just turn it sideways, just a bit easier that way. So especially with all, okay, because also because I'm working so large. It's quite a lot of marks to do, yeah. Make sure this is still recording. Yeah, I think we'll have a break at about 10:30. And because we actually got started quite quickly this morning, so. And look, I do look at my reference quite a lot. I mean, you don't have to look at your reference, you know, when it comes to this woody part. I mean, this you can really make up as you go along, you know, so it's really not necessary. But I just find, for me, being a visual artist, I do tend to like looking at textures and what's in front of me, because otherwise you tend to make patterns and things like that, you know. Your brain does, it just automatically will make a pattern which you don't want, really. You want that sort of randomness in it, you know. It must be random, it mustn't have patterns. Yeah, so you can see that piece of wood now stands out nicely from that piece of wood, you know what I mean? It's got two very quite sort of distinctive textures to them, you know, and it just makes for a more interesting picture as well. Now, there was one stage when I picked it, I still thought, is this going to be interesting enough to actually create something? But it actually is. Actually, I'm enjoying it. Yeah, look, the other one was a door knocker. I think we can have a lot of fun with that as well, but that'll be quite a lot of pen and ink in that one, you know. Yeah, I think that'll be quite nice to do. Yeah, so I think that could be maybe something we do next, you know. And remember, when I do go on to the watercolour part of it, if you guys haven't finished the drawing part completely, it doesn't matter really, because you know you can go back in afterwards and put the pen and ink in, you know. So don't stress too much about being where I am. So. I am putting quite a fair amount of detail in, so you don't have to put quite as much as me. You'll see this door over here. I'm gonna just put a few little sketch lines in, but I'm really not going to add too much because I want the plants to stand out from it, you know. So I'm not gonna make too much texture. And because it'll be quite light, we will be able to do a wash over the pots, because you know the pots are going to be a lot darker than the area. So we can just sort of work around the pots. We don't have to mask all the flowers and everything out, unless you happen to have a white flower against a red door. So in that respect, we don't need to mask any of this out. We can just leave it, do our wash, and then put our colour, you know, coloured pots and our leaves and all that on top of it. So we don't have to stress too much about that. This is actually, now that I'm coming back, it's actually good to stand up and then look at it, and it's actually got a beautiful feel about it. I'm really enjoying keeping this sort of relatively simple and then having this like a wonderful frame around it, you know what I mean? It's like literally a frame, which is fabulous. So it actually looks quite nice, actually, quite cool. definitely keep this very light, definitely very, very pale, just like almost just like off-white, you know, with a hint of colour here and there. But yeah, I'm actually quite chuffed with this. I mean, I must be honest, sometimes with those small little sketches of mine, I sometimes look at them and think, oh, they're actually quite nice. I sort of always don't want to put paint on them, you know. That's why I like to pick something with something, like a door or a window or something that's got texture, you know. So a scene is fine. I mean, like they've wanted to look at another pass, it's lovely, but I prefer something with a bit more something. So you've got to be really particular about what you pick, you know, when you're doing a scene. It's not just vague, it must be something of interest in it, like the rocks, for instance, or whatever, you know. But I mean, travel sketching can also be the small things, you know, like a flower or something that you, an interesting plant, you know, or a beetle, whatever. It can also be interesting, so. Yeah, I must be honest, this number one is definitely my go-to pen. I just find it sort of does everything, if you know what I mean. So I can get very fine lines. I don't need the very fine one necessarily, unless I'm going to do a lot of fine work. Yeah, and then the five I'll just bring in when I need to really bring in a very thick line. Like for these thick lines, I could probably use a five, you know, to bring dark lines in. But I find this number one, I've noticed that when I'm busy drawing, I tend to stick with this. It just seems to work very well for me. Yeah, it's a nice go-to thing. And also the nib lasts relatively long as well. Yeah, because that's the biggest thing as well, is the wear and tear on the nibs, you know. You have to be some, you have to, yeah, literally, yeah, and just you know, just it's simplistic, if you know what I'm saying. So, you know, look, I know my work that I do, my big paintings, is different. I mean, it's palette knife as well, but it's a different type of palette knife work. I just haven't carried on with it. It's actually a large one that's got quilted trees and that in it, which I started a while back before I left on the retreat. But because I'm helping my husband with his business at the moment, till we find somebody, I just haven't got the, yeah, there's, thank you, that's the word, I don't have the headspace. I keep on thinking of the word, but that is actually what it is. I don't have that at the moment too. So that's what I've been just doing, the travel sketching and the little books, and because it's sort of very non, I don't feel like I have to finish it and do that. It's just something I can enjoy doing. So I just thought I'm going to put that painting aside until next year. You know, because in January, we're basically working up until the 15th of December. And then he and I will be on our bikes, and we're going to go and do our bike trip to the Karoo and all that, you know. So, yeah, so, and then when we get back, it's basically straight back. I've got to start training somebody for the business. So I really am not going to have any free time per se to actually do any of my own work doing, so, besides the travel sketching and that sort of thing. So, yeah. So here I'm just using a bit of stippling, so you'll see just to get a different texture, because the side of that, just to change it a bit, because I want this lip to stand out from this part, and it is slightly different, so it's got more of a sort of like a rough texture. So I thought, let me just use a bit of stippling there. Here you could, if you really wanted to, you could pick up that very fine pen and get a finer stipple. But I'm not going to worry too much, otherwise it's going to take forever to do this. I can't do that. What helps with this sort of drawing is the fact, because it's immediate and you can't change it, it takes a bit of pressure off you, because you know you're not going to be able to recreate the exact same thing that you see in front of you. It isn't going to be the same. You can just sort of get an idea of it, you know what I'm saying? So you sort of, it's not about making an exact replica, because it's not, you can't do that, you know, so. Part of this won't actually take all that long to do, to be honest, the painting part of it, you know, because this is more about these textures and stuff that you're creating. the sun's come out. So I think with this bottom section over here, you know, it's all these lovely rough textures. I think with that section, I'm not going to put the pen and ink in this wall part here. Okay. The reason being, like we did with the with those rocks, you're going to let the salt and that dictate what's going to happen to the textures here. And then we can use the pen and ink, and then rather use the pen and ink to bring back in some of the pen and ink, the sort of finer details, you know what I'm saying? So I'm a bit worried about bringing this in and then putting the paint and then the salt, because you're just not going to be quite sure what the salt's going to do. So I think I'd rather go with that and rather just do the window and all that with the pen and ink. Do the salt section over here with that. Let's see what happens with that. And then go into that with the pen and ink. I think that's probably a better idea. I think that'll work quite well. Too much in there, I don't think, in there. And I'm also not going to worry about putting that cable in, obviously, okay, because that just looks weird. It's a little bit weird. What I will do is I will bring in that piece of plaster there, just with the pen, just so I know when I'm painting where to put it. just putting one or two sort of little marks on this wall. I'm not going to do anything hectic, just to sort of at least give it some feeling. Maybe you can always add later if you want to. To look at this now from a bit of a distance and just see where there's any spots there that stand out too much, you know, like sort of in your face, like that's quite a big black spot over there. So I might just bring one or two smaller ones in here, because at the moment it's a big black spot and then nothing really. I probably made it a bit large. So I think I'm going to, yeah, I sort of continue as if it's continuing behind the pot, because at the moment it just looks like a blob. Yeah, so that's the sort of thing you need to look at when you look at it as a whole, like what stands out and is going to be too much. Obviously we're going to be putting paint on, but it doesn't help to have something that's just in your face, you know, as well. So I'm going to sort of try and continue as if, because that might then just make it look not quite so out of place. And this is where we have artistic license. It's a wonderful thing, artistic license. Themselves, that will also help a bit. I think it's just the plants are so light in comparison at the moment that the pot stands out a fair amount. I mean, not the pot, the mark. So if we continue here as well, make this a bit darker, we can maybe then make it not quite so stand out quite as much. Oh, reminds me, I didn't actually put this phone on charge. I wonder how much charge it's got left. I have no idea. I'll have to plug it in just now. Yeah, so that already looks better. That black spot doesn't look quite so in your face. Put something around it as well, it will help. Yeah. And also, once I put some colour over here, because remember, I'm comparing that to compared to the white as well, which also, you know, when you look at it without the white section, it doesn't look that bad. Whereas if you look at it over here, against not this white section, but this empty section, it looks a bit strange. So what I could do is just bring a little bit of texture into here, and then it won't look quite so bizarre. That's why one has to be quite careful. One mustn't actually just go in and just see a big black dot and put it in, you know what I mean? Which is what I did there. I should have actually considered the whole thing first before I decided to do that. Even although it's there, you know what I mean? So this is where you have to use your judgment. Oh, it looks a bit better. It doesn't look quite so in your face. You'll see most of the marks that I am using here are following the grain of the wood. Okay, so I haven't got any other marks going in the opposite direction. So I try and stick, even when I'm doing this sort of thing over here, I don't make any other marks besides the grain of the wood. Following the grain of the wood. I don't just make any random opposite direction marks. So you don't want to do any cross-hatching or anything like that here, because that is just going to really look completely wrong. I actually quite like that. I think that actually works quite well. I'm going to start erasing the pencil marks that I made carefully. If they're very light, you're not going to really notice them anyway, so let's just let this other girl know that we'll start with the watercolour at 11. Yeah, so I'm just being very careful not to rub, okay, so no rubbing. Some paper can actually take the rubbing quite well, but I've noticed, like this is the agave, that's this one, that's agave watercolour. So it is 20%, 30% cotton rag and 70% agave fibre. Agave, I don't know how you say it. Anyway, so I've noticed agave, yeah, I think it's agave, yeah. So I noticed this the one day when I was working on something when I erased, then it sort of made quite a weird texture afterwards. So I'm just being very careful just to. Okay, obviously, certain areas I'm going to have to erase. Actually makes quite a nice drawing just on its own, you know. That's it. I'm going to leave it like that, and then it's almost time for our break anyway, so. Okay, I'm just going to clean my palette is quite dirty. Use that. I'm not going to use my large palette because this is actually more than big enough. So yeah, I mean I've got the large one, but I'm not going to use that. Because I'm not really going to be working with a lot of deep colour, so I can get away with just working with the small one. Also, then you don't waste as much paint as well. You know, when you've got such a big palette, you tend to be more inclined to sort of use a lot of paint sometimes. It actually amazes me how watercolour, even watercolour, can actually stain wood. I mean, not wood, steel. How bizarre, actually. You wouldn't think so, hey? But blue is an incredibly strong pigment, it tends to stain everything. So. So I'm going to have the Epsom salts available if you want to use the Epsom salts, and then I've got the fine salt as well, and I've got the coarser salt. I didn't use this last time, but I might actually use this time round. I want it to be interesting to see because it's got quite big sort of marks of sort of textures over there. So I might try this and then see how that pans out. Remember, you can always test it on another piece. What's nice about doing it this way is you can actually add more detail if you want to afterwards, you know. And then, so sometimes one can add less detail, then put the watercolour on and then add more detail if you want to. But with me, I just decided I wanted to put in all this lovely detail that I could see. And that's just using the micron pens I was telling you about. So that's what they look like. So it's just a micron pen, and you get different size nibs. So, but with this picture, I literally just use the 0.1. That's sort of it's like a go-to nib that you can sort of do most of the work with. You don't need all the fine ones are nice if you're doing something more delicate, like birds and stuff like that, and feathers and things. And then the 0.5 is if you've got very big dark areas that you need to sort of get colored in, basically. So for instance, if you're doing something like this,
then, you know, like you want to use a 0.5 for that. You don't want to use that pen. It'll take you forever to fill that in. Do you know what I'm saying? So that's just for the bigger areas. So you don't often use that. It's only if you've got big dark areas that you want to fill in.
Okay,
so we tend to just use very basic colors, nothing too fancy, just the basic colors that we find sort of in the color wheel, a cool and a warm of each color. So here I've got a cool and a warm of the yellow, a cool and a warm of the red. Then I've got my different browns. So I've got a burnt sienna, I've got a raw sienna, and then I've got a burnt umber. And then I've got the warm and the cold blues as well, so a thylo and a French ultramarine. And then this one I just happen to have on the side. It's one of the colors that Daniel Smith make. So it's called Buff Titanium. So this is not a color you get any other make. There's no other brand makes that, so that's specifically a color they make. Very nice for if you're doing rocks and sort of things. So it's a nice color. It's an opaque color. You don't often see that in watercolors, you know, besides white. But I just find it's fabulous, especially with me doing the landscapes. It's a nice color that you would want to mix with your watercolors, but you find it difficult to mix that color. So it's nice just to have it as a standby color. But on the whole, we're just basically going to be using these ones. We're not going to use anything else. Very similar to the palette knife, using the basic warm and cools of each color. You don't really need more than that, you know. And then I'm going to mix my colors on here. I have got a big palette. It's nice to have a big palette if you're working in a very large area and you're going to be putting a lot of color down, very intense color down. So say you're going to be putting a nice big blue sky down, then obviously you want a palette that's got more space like that, that you can mix a lot of blue so that you can put all the blue down in one go. And this will be a little bit smaller for that. But because I'm not doing a massive wash or very dark colored wash, I'm going to just stick with this small palette of mine. Okay, brushes wise, we have a variety of brushes. Just like the standard set of brushes is normally fine, but you need at least one big brush, sort of like that, or what we call a mop brush. A mop brush is just for putting water down, and then we put our color mixing on top of that, you know, colors on top of that, and let it bleed in, which is what we're going to be doing just now. This holds a lot of water, so you can put a lot of water on your paper. And then the paper I mentioned to you has to be quite thick, so this one is a 300 GSM. This one comes in a pad, so it's all sort of joined together. It's all like stuck together. So it's so you just take it off as you finish painting on it, so it doesn't warp then. And the reason we put tape around it is just to give our picture a bit of a nice edge, which is nice, a nice finish, you know. Okay, right. Okay, so we're going to mix the colors. Oh, we're going to use salt with this as well. So we've got some normal salt, table salt, some Epsom salts, and we've got some a coarser salt. This is actually a Malden salt, I think it's called. A much coarser salt. And each salt will give you sort of a different effect on the paper. Or on the watercolor, should I say. Okay, cool. Right, so let me just get my reference. Where is my phone? Oh, that might help a lot. Oh, gorgeous. It doesn't help to have two phones on it. Okay, cool. So let me just get the reference again. Okay, so the reference, I did do a bit of editing on it with a Photoshop thing, just to give it a bit more colour and all that, but one can actually change the colour. So you can see I did some edits like that. So the colours are entirely up to you. You can decide what colours you want to use here, guys. You can literally bring anything you want in there. With regards to the pots, I'm going to keep the pots nice and colourful, so I'm going to probably do a red one, and then I'm going to do maybe a sort of a turquoisey one as well, I think would work quite well, and then perhaps even a yellow one as well. So that will sort of give us almost like the three colours, which is quite nice to have in a painting, to have a few sort of primary colours, so to speak. Okay. But what we're going to do first is we're going to do the wash on the inside of the window, which is sort of that sort of pale yellow wash, darker in certain areas. Remember, because these flowers and these plants and the pots aren't light colored, if they were white or something, then we would use the masking fluid to mask it out. But because we're not doing that, we're just using a very pale color, you can actually wash over the pots
with no problem at all. You don't have to worry about going around them because we're going to be putting the dark colors on top of that anyway, so it's not a problem. Okay, obviously you can't do the pots first and then do the wash up. That's not going to really work very well. So yeah, the other paint, other brush you can also use is a square one for doing a wash as well, so if you've got more control, if you've got like a square area. Okay, so I'm first going to mix the color that I'm going to use here. So it's a nice warm yellow, so I'm going to use a cadmium yellow. Remember, if you're going to be using salts, you must have two different water, one for cleaning your paintbrush if you happen to dip it into the salt as well. You don't normally dip your paintbrush into the salt, but sometimes you add a bit of texture to it and then you're actually touching the salt, and you don't want to have salt in your other water as well, the one that you're actually using just with your plain watercolors, because it does affect the texture. So I'm just mixing up some yellow there. So this yellow is quite bright. If I had to go and put this on directly now, it would actually be very, very strong and it would be too bright. I don't want that. You can only see this sort of brightish behind the pots. And then also the pots have got a bit of a shadow cast on them as well. So I want to be able to bring some of that in as well. So I'm going to add a bit of the burnt sienna. I'm going to have a little bit of that on the side. If you don't have a burnt sienna, you can have a bit of yellow ochre if you want to. You've got a yellow ochre there. So I haven't activated these paints. Normally what we do is, so these paints are taken out of a tube and put into these little things. So I use tube paints generally, but because I don't want to use all the colors, I didn't see the point in activating them all. So what I normally mean is you just take a spray bottle and you just spray a little bit of water on them and then those paints are activated. Otherwise you can buy the blocks as well, but I personally prefer the tubes. So this is my travel sketching palette, this that I'm busy using now. Okay, and I'm just going to activate the red and the one blue. So I'll just put a drop of water on there, just so that I can start getting wet in the meantime. Otherwise, I just use a spray bottle, just with the fine spray. Okay. Cool. Okay, so I've got my brighter yellow, and actually, you know what, I'm going to have a little bit of dark brown, so the burnt umber, I'm going to have a little bit of that on the side as well, just for some of the darker areas. We don't have black in the palette because black is a very dead colour, so to make a black we normally mix the two together. We'll use the brown and the French ultramarine to make a darker colour. Okay, so yeah, black can be very harsh. Okay, so there I've got my colours. I'm going to have one paintbrush to put on the paint with, the water with, and then I'll use another paintbrush to put the paint on with. Depending on the size of the area that you're going to cover, that will determine the size of the brush that you're going to be using to put the colour on, and also how much you want to pick up. So I'm going to use the same brush to put the colour on, that size brush, but initially I'm going to first put down a wash. So we're going to do what we call a wash. So always plan before you put it down. So don't just put the water on and then decide, okay, where am I going to put the paint now? So have an idea of where, as soon as you've got the water down, because remember, if it's very hot, we're going to end up drying very quickly. And then you'll be hesitating. And if you hesitate too long, certain areas are going to dry. And then you're not going to get that nice sort of clear wash that you want. Well, not clear wash, but you're not going to get a nice smooth wash. Maybe you can work flat as well if you want to, if you don't want to run down slightly, but I don't mind it running down a little slightly. So I'm just going to do the inside window. So I'm going to wet that relatively substantially because I don't want it too dark anyway. The amount of water will determine the how dark your colour is going to be, and also how much pigment you put down as well. That will also determine how dark it's going to be. So I'm going to take that down behind my pots here. So I'm just going to go over the pots.
Yeah, and Lee, you'll see it will always, the paper's always going to warp anyway, but then when it dries, it flattens again. Because it's been tied down, yeah. Not tied down, it's been taped down. Okay, so we just stop talking and actually concentrate, yeah? So I can use this brush if I want to, also just to put the paint down. You can see how strong that paint is, okay? It's quite a strong colour. So I'm going to just do the wash. And the trick with this paint is not to overwork it. You can also wipe off in areas as well. You can actually have some cloth. So say for instance you've done an area and you want it to be slightly whiter, you don't want it to be quite so yellow or whatever it is. You can either move the paint around with your paintbrush or you can actually dab it off, but then it's going to leave quite a harsh mark. Okay, so you've got to be careful you don't, if you dab, when we make clouds we do that. We put down blue and then we dab it with this. But instead I'm just going to wipe my paintbrush. And just move the water around a bit. And just the areas where I don't want it quite so bright. So it's quite wet now, so it doesn't really leave any brush marks or anything because it's quite wet. So all I'm doing is I'm just wiping some of the colour off here. I just want it just a bit paler. And you can put another layer on top as well. Look, it is important to use quite good quality paper. Okay, there's just nothing worse than working with cheap paper and then you just end up with this very difficult medium to work with, and then that's why a lot of people give up when it comes to watercolours, because they're using the wrong tools. Okay, so, right, so now it's still wet over here, so I'm bringing in that darker sort of brown that I see here. So that's it. And then you can pick up colour directly off the palette, and you can also, if you want it a little bit more intense, you can just pick it up directly off. I'm going to use a bit of burnt sienna as well. You see, I'm actually busy working around the pots now. I don't want them to be nasty. You see there, you can actually take this and actually wipe your pots clear again, like that. You see how then you can actually take the colour off. But this doesn't work if you're using cheap paint, okay? Not cheap paint, cheap paper. If you use cheap paper, that doesn't work. All it does is it actually just damages the paper. And because it's nice and cool today, I've got a fair amount of time to actually work with this in here. If it was very hot, it would actually disappear quite quickly. It actually gets quite marks. It actually have marks, not bleeding. So you can see it's still bleeding into the paper, into the water. This is why I'm saying about having good quality paper, because if you buy cheap paper, what happens is the cheap paper just sucks the water and the paint in, and then you're just left with these, as soon as I do this, you're just left with these harsh marks. As you can see, I'm trying to sort of get the general idea and the general feel. I haven't done this edge yet, I'll just do that afterwards. I just wanted to get this part down first. If you have pools of water, then you just pick them up with you. Each of your paper. So I'm just squinting my eyes. I'm imagining how dark the pots are going to be, and is this going to be dark enough for the background? So I think I'm going to make it a fraction darker just behind the pots there. Just not much. I'm not making it black or anything, but I really want to get that sort of shadowy feel. And with watercolours, we tend to work the opposite to oils. We tend to work from light to dark, not the other way around. Because remember, your paper is actually your white. Okay. Let's use a smaller paintbrush here, just to get into those little corners there.
Let's brighten this up a little bit. So I quite like that yellow there. It'll make for a nice contrast. And don't ever try and copy your picture exactly, because it's not going to happen. Watercolour is very much a happy accident. Very difficult to control it exactly. It just doesn't do that. That's how a lot of people find it very difficult to work with, because they want to control it, and it has its own mind. Okay, so there I've done that part, and that makes you very happy with that. Okay, so just remember, when you're working with this, now we can't go into the pots now because this paint is wet around it, this area is wet. So as soon as we put a colour down now, it's just going to bleed into the rest of your paper. So we're going to work in an area now where the paint isn't wet, okay. Or not the paper, the paint, where the paper is not wet, okay. So I'm going to now work on this piece of wood at the bottom over here, and then I'll work on those areas as well. Remember, you can turn it around if you want to. If you want to work sideways or whatever, remember, you can just pick up your paper and do that. Okay, so I'm going to work with this section now, that bottom section. And remember, you don't have to like stare at your reference, but I quite like these colors here, so I'm going to try and get them quite accurate. You can also just do your own thing, artistic license and all that stuff. So here, I'm not going to wet it first. I actually don't want it to bleed in, because I want to try and keep some of the whites here. Okay, so here I'm going to put the paint on directly and just try and stick to what I see in front of me. And here, just to try, it's always better to leave the whites, if you can, behind than to try and put them back. Because in order to put them back, you either have to try and wipe it off, but it'll never be as white as the original paper. Or otherwise you have to use the gouache or an acrylic or something like that to bring the whites back, and it just isn't quite the same. It's fine if you're using a very fine little area that you need to bring a bit of white down back into, but if you try and do it like this big area over here, if I try to do that now with white paint, it won't match the paper, and it'll look wrong. Okay. Yeah, so it's not an easy medium to work with. When you've initially started, it can be quite frustrating, because it literally just does what it wants, you know. And you do learn to control it, because it's all about the type of paper, for one thing, and then the other thing is it's about the amount of water on the paper, the amount of water you add to your paint, the temperature of the day. If it's very hot, it's going to dry faster. How quickly you work. You know, so once you start working with watercolour, then you start learning how the watercolour reacts to everything. It, you know, to that specific paper, to the amount of water that you put in, etc. And that comes with practice, like with anything. You can ask these two ladies, they've been at it for a very long time. Hey guys. They've been doing it for all the time, y'all. And they've been with me since COVID, so. I know, yeah. When I first started the COVID lessons, it's a very long time, y'all. And bring a little bit of the yellow into here as well. I just want to sort of continue that that yellow into this bottom piece of wood. You can do that. You also get what we call a dry brush technique. That's when you actually pick up a dry brush, but we use that when we're doing more sort of textures and that sort of thing, as in dragging big areas. Okay, so, and also what's good to do is, just like with the palette knife, painting. You can stand up
and actually look at it and decide, is it working for you? Is it not working for you? Have I done enough? Etc. So for the moment, I'm going to leave that. Remember, I can always add more to it if I want to. And then I'm going to move on to the other parts. Just remember, it can also smudge. So just be careful if you put your hand down. Sometimes it's better just to turn it around if you're going to be working in another area. But I'm going to be working on the side here. Very similar colours to the ones I've just used. With a bit of variation. Also, just going to go in dry. I'm not going to wet my paper first. I don't want it to bleed. Almost see a bit of purple in there, so I could actually just maybe mix a bit of purple here. Might put that in also. I quite like it in the photograph. Oh, somebody's busy crackling. Who's crackling? Yeah. Somebody's microphone is catching on something, or there's a hell of a crackle in the air. Oh, okay. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to start bringing that. So you can see here, I didn't put a lot of pen and ink compared to the other sections. But remember, you can always bring back in again if you want to. So I'm using. If you use a good quality brush, I mean, this one's, it is prime art, but it's still a good quality brush. Just because it says prime art doesn't mean it's not good quality. And if you look after your brushes, then, I mean, this one's kept a point for a very long time. It's got a nice sharp point to work with, and I can get some very fine, even though it's a big brush, I can actually get some very fine lines. Otherwise, you just get a brush with very fine, with a fine lip as well.
Okay. Yeah, because look, I mean, you wouldn't be able to, yeah, look, you wouldn't be able to get this sort of effect at all with acrylics unless you mixed your stuff with white. And that's the reason I like using this also as well, because I'm using pen and ink. So if I had pen and ink, I would never be able to work on top of the pen and ink with acrylics. So that's the advantage of working with the watercolors, you know. Well, you can't really do it any other way. You have to work with the watercolors in this respect, you know, with the pen and ink. It's just because we do combine the two, yeah. And also, look, the watercolors, yeah. I mean, look, acrylics, yes, you can acrylics, but yeah, it's a very opaque sort of medium. Acrylics, you know, you can. I know you can do washes to a point, but on the whole, it is an opaque medium, you know. So whereas watercolors is really based on using the white of the paper as your white. So you can see I'm leaving the whites behind, and that is your white. You never put white into it again, you know. So yeah, so I would never use that, this sort of thing. I would never use acrylics. Then I may as well just use the oil paint, you know. Yeah, it's got its own unique set of problems, or I don't know, not problems, but it's a unique set of properties. That's the word I'm looking for, so properties, yeah. Okay, so I'm going to turn it upside down, and then I'm going to work on the other ones, just so that I don't initially smudge. I know it's not very wet, it won't just form a smudge, but it might, so I don't want to take a chance. Also, it's a really nice go-to medium. It's like we were discussing now before you arrived. You know, you use it for travel sketching, watercolors, pen, ink, and watercolors. You know, so I mean, this is your whole. That's all you need. You just need that, some brushes, some pens, and some water. That's it. That's all you need. You know, you don't need to drag a whole big thing around with you. You know, so it's got huge advantages in that sense. Look, in the old days. I always say the old days, but the days before. So when Turner and all that, if you look at, like for instance, Turner's work or whatever, the British artists, some of the American artists, and a lot of them used watercolour, but they used it more as a sort of a study for drawing. So that they would go out into to wherever they're going to paint or what area they wanted to capture. And they would take their watercolors with, and they would quickly capture the colors and get an idea of the thing that they were going to paint in their studio, you know. So it would be like a study, just basically. And the only reason they did that was because there was no such thing as oil paints in tubes, you know. And it was a hell of a mission to carry around a wet oil painting. So yeah, so they would literally just carry this around, and they would do their little thing. And then when tubes came into the picture, then that's when you started getting the impressionists and the plein air painters. So watercolour is very much about impressionistic painting. It's more of an impression, not necessarily a final super realistic painting. But then again, you get those people. There's a lady, I can never remember, I never how to say her name, Rudurik. She does these super realistic watercolour paintings. You do get people that do the most incredible watercolour paintings. But I said the patience of a saint to be able to do that. Where they do it extremely realistically. And it looks like she does all these pebbles and things like that. And so you just look at it and it looks like a real picture. Like an actual photograph. It's quite incredible. But yet when you zoom in, you can see that it's watercolour. And there's just certain effects you can't get with any other paints. And also, once you lose your fear of the medium as well, because it is, it's quite a tricky medium to learn initially. That's why when I offer, you know, I always offer my experimental workshop with all the different, you know, playing around with watercolors and the salts and all that as well, and it just takes the fear out of it, because a lot of people are fearful of working with watercolor, and it's a fun way of learning how to work with watercolor instead of going in and learning how to do all these ginormous washes. And when I went and did a course with a watercolor artist, he was very much a realist, you know, he was an architect, so he did all these big washes. So that's the first thing I learned, and it was quite terrifying, to be frank. So that's a creep. Yeah, no, it's, but that was his style, you know, so. I think this is relatively dry. Yeah, the way you can tell if it is dry is just by putting the back of your hand on it. If it's cool, then it's still damp. But look, it's still warped, but it's not so wet that my colour is going to bleed into it where I touch it over here. So I'm not too stressed about that. Where are you going, Paris? So I've got a parrot. Where are you going? You are, no, you can't. Oh, he wants to come and sit here with me. He's been trying to climb up, trying to figure out how to get to my stuff here. I've got an African grey, by the way, so if you're wondering who I'm talking about. And then I can always come back into it if I want to add more textures, but I'm first going to do some other stuff. I'm going to do the side of that one now. So also, well, with the watercolors, you have a reference, but you just follow it sort of loosely, you know. You're not going to try and copy it exactly, otherwise you'll spend all day here. The beak, stay there. No, you can't come here. Ah. I cannot have my cell phone.
Exactly what you want. Come up.
You can't have that stuff. Yeah. So this is my African grey. He's trying to get to my paints and my paintbrushes, and yeah, he likes to just go sit up there. You want something to paint with?
I've got an old pen for you.
Yeah. Yeah. Keep him occupied for a while. That's actually quite a relaxing sort of medium as well. You sort of just sit here, the pen and ink especially, we were just saying earlier on how the pen and ink is such a relaxing medium, you know. You sort of lose yourself in all the marks and the mark making, and yeah, it's very therapeutic. And with this sort of more detailed work that we're busy doing, with these fine lines and stuff like that, it's quite a therapeutic one. Way of painting. Okay. You can make the colours darker if you don't make them dark, and there should be when you're putting your paint down and you decide you need it slightly dark in an area, then you can do what we call a wash on top of it. Sort of like glazing when you do painting. And you just do a wash on top. But you normally just wait for the bottom layer to dry before you do that. Because when you, obviously because it's watercolour, if I go and wet this again, obviously you're going to be taking some of the paint off because it's not permanent. Okay, so it is waterproof. It's non-waterproof, I mean, it's not waterproof. Do like a soft yellow in the middle. Some parts there. So I can bring some more colours in a bit later, but what I want to do is I want to do the outside wall first, and then if I need to bring in more in this, then I will. So yeah, I'd rather opt for a little bit less and then bring back into it again afterwards. If you see that it needs it. Because we're going to be doing this outside wall, we're going to be doing a bit of a wash for the outside wall. Okay. little darker, so I'm just basically going over it again slightly. And here as well. So with watercolour, your contrasts are actually quite important. To get the contrast, not necessarily just in black and white, as in like tonal values, but colour-wise. It's very, it's such a delicate medium. Okay, I'm going to do the pots now. Let's see how dry this is. Yeah, it's dry enough to do the pots. I'm going to do the pots before I do the salt with the watercolour over there, because otherwise it'll be a vision for me to try and work on top of this, because the salts take quite a fair amount to dry. They're not as quick as that. It tends to sort of hold the water a little bit more, a little bit longer. So the texture part I'm going to do afterwards. So now I'm just going to decide which pot to put where and what flowers to put where. So what do you think? I'm going to make a little blue pot. Well, let's start off with that one. I'm going to put like a turquoise color here. I'm going to just clean my palette. Oh, the other advantage only is watercolour paints may be initially expensive when you buy them, but they last forever. As you can see, I mean, you hardly use anything, you know, so. Very rare I get the colour first time. Few little white spots there because it makes the pot interesting, and also then you can actually see it's watercolour. Okay, I think I'm going to this one. I'm going to do a red pot, so I'm going to give this a green base. Next one, I'm going to do a red pot. But I'm not going to use this bright red, it's a bit too bright. And it's, you know, we've already got those oranges and that in there, so I'm going to mix my my warm and my cool blue together. Just to sort of get a nice red, but I don't want the pinky red either, so I want sort of a, almost what we call a primary red. Actually nice and cheerful, that's for sure. I still haven't decided what the middle pot's colour must be. No, I'm just deciding what you're going to do. And I'm also sort of debating now. Yeah, I like the two, the green and the red. I'm just trying to think what would work. Yes, I do. You're quite right. That is a Le Creuset colour. I've got a butter dish that colour. You're actually quite right. You know what? I'm gonna put the greens in first. I'm also a bit wary to commit to that middle one. I haven't decided what colour it's going to be yet, so I think I'm going to carry on first and just do some other stuff. Oh, I don't want to make the greens too bright, but I don't want to make them too dull either. Oops, not to dirty my paints. No, that's not a nice green, I'm going to do that one. It's a bit too browny green that I'm liking. I'm going to use a cold yellow with a bit of a warm blue, which should give me the green I'm looking for. Yeah, that will work. So again, starting off light and then putting the darks in afterwards. So I'm just putting the light greens in initially, and then I'll put, if I want to put some shadows in there, I will, because they'll definitely need something to make them stand out a bit more. But just initially, I'm going to just do these light greens. You can see why I kept that background quite light. Otherwise, you can see as we go down that those colours don't work, and we would have had to mask it out to make them stand out more. Going to make this a very bright yellow flower, just for the hell of it. I think that could actually stand out quite nicely. show his pot looks quite sad. It's got no flower. You should add a pink flower or something. Just stand up and look at it again.
At the moment, I'm just so close to it, I can't see the. What would they say? The wood for the trees. It's actually looking quite nice. I'm almost tempted to make this quite a dark pot. I think it might work quite nicely. Almost like a dark blue. Yeah. It needs something. Because I make it yellow or something, it's just, I don't know. Yellow. You see, this is where, like, if you're really, really, really not sure, 100% sure, what you want to do, I'm going to get a piece of paper quickly. This is a way to do it. Yeah, especially with something like this, and you don't want to commit to a specific color because you're just not 100% sure if it's going to work. Then one can actually just tear a piece of paper, and because watercolors are so cheap, relatively speaking, just sort of tear a piece of paper to the shape. We do this with oil painting occasionally as well, but the thing is with oils, you know, you can put it on and you decide you don't like it, you can take it off. Not so easy with this. And then paint your pot yellow, or whatever you want to paint it, on that piece of paper. And then use that and put it down and decide yes or no. So you see, that gives you a general idea of what it's going to look like, you know? And then it just helps you to not have to commit necessarily to, actually, yellow doesn't actually look too bad. With a bit of orange added to it, it might actually work quite well because it's much brighter than the surrounding the ones. I actually quite like that. I think that might actually go with that. But then again, as I said, then you can go back and then you can, you see if I put black there, I just decided I like the yellow. I think that works for me. Like initially I wasn't sure, but now I'm sure. You guys are very quiet. My word. You're like, sorry, this thing fell out of my ear here. Only you still there. You? Oh, okay. Now I decided the yellow for me. It actually does look nice. I'm making it, so I'm making the paint quite thick. Annalie, are you still there? Hello? If you are there, I can't hear you because your mic's off. Hello? Oh, okay. today's class, okay. Okay. What I'm going to do is then, because the other pots are slightly darker on the side, I'll just add a bit of orange to the side. Just to, you know. And I haven't left the white. I've decided not to leave this one with a bit of white. I've decided to make it quite a nice sort of solid colour. Yeah, I think that works for me. Okay, so the inside of the pots are going to be black. So I'm just going to do the inside of the pots, which are dark. So that contrast will also make them stand out quite nicely. Yeah, sure, Madeline, you don't have to hang around all the time. If you've sort of seen what you want to see, you're welcome to go. You mustn't think you're being rude at all. Don't stress. Oh, good, okay. Yeah, we're having fun with all our dilemmas here, what we want to colours and stuff.
that parrot is destroying that pen, I'll tell you something. So I'm going to make a slightly darker green for the leaves now. I want to go back into those leaves and make them a little bit darker, just in certain areas. One doesn't have to, one can actually just leave them like that. Nobody would know any different. But yeah, I just want to, oh dear, wrong green, Sharon. And then, before some of the leaves. I bought myself some very, very fine paintbrushes the other day. Not necessarily for watercolour, but they're called fine detail brushes. So it would actually be nice for this sort of thing. But like if you're signing your signature or something like that, or in certain areas, especially doing portraits and things like that, you want fine details. Very nice to have. They'll probably last me forever because I don't think I'll use them that often. Oh, you see how immediately that just gives it a bit more interest. Just makes the leaves pop a bit more. Just now they weren't really popping, they were just sort of just there. You don't cover all the green. And these are made up plants anyway, so I'm sure they do exist somewhere in the world. So you'll see I'm just busy putting some marks down on the wood just to give it a bit of roughness, but I'm actually using my finger as well. So just by picking up a bit of paint, not much on the paintbrush, sort of dragging it a little bit and then using my finger to create some textures. It's almost a bit of a what we call a dry brush, so using the side of the brush and then dragging it so you can see it gets a nice texture. There we go, it actually worked quite nicely. So now I've got a bit of a texture going as well, and yeah, I just wanted to bring a little bit of texture into here, but nothing too much in your face, because otherwise it's going to compete with the flowers and I don't want it to do that. But I do want that wood to look sort of oldish, and at the moment it just looks a bit too plain, so maybe just in the edges and the corners over here where they meet up and have a bit of color. And often that you only pick up once you actually start painting the other stuff. There's only, like in a session like this, you'll see everybody's turns out differently, you know. Not everybody's the same. which is nice. It's always wonderful to see at the end, you know, who's done what with their stuff, you know. So we all have our own different styles. So nobody's will look like mine. It will all look, everybody's will look slightly different, you know. That aged look, y'all. That's why I love painting stuff like this. This old sort of... these drawn tree sort of things, you know. Like we did a beautiful lantern the one time, and that was awesome. An old... lots of salt. So you'll see when we put the salts in that down. What is the time, guys? Oh my word, it's 12:15. Put my arse into gear. Sorry, guys. I would go horribly sighted with this window. I had no idea what the time was. Sorry. Okay, so, but I'm happy with that. I think what I'll do there is I'm going to leave that, and if I want to bring in some more details, I can, but I don't want to go too overboard. I want to get this other piece down over here. So I've got my colors. Okay, so I've got the yellows and oranges that I want, and I might bring in some of that purpley look that's in my picture. I quite like that sort of purple, so I'm going to keep with that, some of that down. Okay, so okay, I'm going to have the salts ready. I'm going to use a bit of the coarse salts to see what happens. I haven't tried this particular one before, and then I'm going to use some of the normal salt as well. So here you need water to activate the salt. So if you can't just put paint down and then salt, nothing's going to happen. So you actually have to put water down first, and then you put the salt on top of the colors. So water, colors, salt. Okay, so here I'm going to wet it. I'm going to use a mop brush because the mop brush holds a bit more water. It doesn't matter if the water's a bit dirty, because then I can actually sort of see where I'm wetting. Okay, so I'm just going to do this bottom section. I'm not going to do the sides for the moment. That we can do when we're done, when you have enough time, you can finish off the sides. But I just want to get this down at least. So I'm going to wet the whole area. Okay. And I'm going to pick up, make sure it's relatively wet, otherwise the salts are not going to activate. And I'm going to put some of my colour down. If I want to. I'm just using mop brush to do it. It works better with darker colours. The salt effect just does. It's quite extreme, but it can help. And it's quite I'm working fast because it's quite a large area, and I just want to get this down so I can get the salts into here. Picking up some of the colors straight out of my palette. Okay, and then I'm going to put the salts on. I'm going to try some of these big ones just to see what happens. Everywhere. Just a few of the bigger ones, and then I'm going to use the normal salt as well. So if you see that already some of it is drying, you can reactivate it by just using a spray bottle, just to reactivate that area. So you won't see the effect now because it's got to dry to get the effect. I mean, just to show you what happens, that's what happens when you do the salt. You get all these fabulous effects, see? Okay, and then there are going to be some darker areas in here as well. So now this is where I'll have my other water that's separate from this one. So this will be my salty water that I'm going to use. And then while this is still wet, I can now go back in here and start dabbing some colours in amongst the salts. You can also wait for it to dry a little bit first if you want to. If you don't want it but you can bring some darker areas in. Just remember to use a different jar. Okay. Remember just to clean your paintbrush, you know, if you're going to dip it back into your actual paint itself, just remember to clean your paintbrush in between, otherwise your paint's going to get salt in it, and that's not so good. Remember, you can also reactivate it, you can add more salt if you want to, but look, once it's sort of dried, you can't really add too much extra. Good, there you are. Actually quite chuffed with that. So. You see, I just left those areas plain because they are sort of plainer. One can go a bit overboard with the salt sometimes. Just depends, you know, where you want to be. So while it's still damp, because if it's not damp, then it doesn't. You want to sort of let it semi bleed in. You can see there it's not so damp anymore. You can actually see it's dried slightly. You can see how fabulous the salts are, Annelie. Much fun. So this is how I actually teach watercolour initially. I make everybody play around with salts and textures and stuff like that. And it just takes a little bit of the fear away. And then also they realise it's about happy accidents, you know, and what I always like to call happy accidents. You just never know what you're going to get until it's dry, you know. So, because it always dries a bit lighter. It dries about 10 to 15% lighter, depending on the colour. Than what you put down, so it'll never be as strong a colour. Okay, that's actually looking very nice, and it's getting a nice bit of a shadow underneath there. That's what I was trying to get. So this part I will leave white for the moment, and only bring, once this is completely dry, then I will bring in this sort of old paint. Okay, to give it a nicer fit. I think I must put more on. I'm a bit wary to put too much more in because it might just detract too much from the pots.
Pots to lose their value. I quite like this purple actually. I thought maybe initially it was a bit strong, but I actually think it looks quite cool. I think I'm going to leave it like that. I don't think I actually want to do too much more. maybe just in this corner,
just a hint of. All right, so this part here I will do afterwards. I'm not going to do it now, guys, because I do have to. Oh, I've still got 3 minutes left. I can do that in 3 minutes. I can do that in 3 minutes. Come, Sharon, come. Okay, so this is going to also just be a pale, palish color. Funny when you think I'm fine, it's actually not, so. Okay. All right, so it has, I can't leave it white because it just looks weird. And you've got to give it a little bit of color. All right, so a little bit of the yellowish to it. So I'm going to do that. And using the same sort of yellow I did before, but also not too much. This is all nice and dry anyway, so I can go ahead and do that now. Not using the water that I just used for the salts. Unless you want to bring a bit of salty texture, you can. If you guys want to continue this all the way around, you can. But to be honest, I think it'll be a bit much. It's going to detract from this, you know. So you can have this lovely effect over here. But if you drag it all the way up here, it's going to be way too much. So I would advise not to. So I'm just not going to take it all the way there because it's going to bleed into it. Otherwise, although that's not always a bad thing. But I actually want to try and keep that white. So, okay, so I'm going to just work this. And then I'm going to quickly do this side. Okay, let me just work the whole thing, but then because it's such a big area, I have to work quite fast. So and I'll probably have to work that again before I go back into it. So I'm not going to go all the way to the edge now, just because that's a bit wet and I don't want to bleed. So this is where, with this sort of picture, the square brush is actually quite handy. Okay, and my yellow in there. Also, when I take the tape off now, I'll have a nice little white edge to it. It's just a very pale wash. Just to define it. And the white. And remember this wall as well, if you want to afterwards, you know, it's always good to wait a bit and give it a day or so and then come back to it, and then immediately you'll see something that might be changing or whatever, because now we've been working at this since 8:30, so our eyes are tired and our brains are tired. And so this, I'm going to add a bit of texture. So I'm just going to take a damp, not a damp, a dry piece of paper, and then I'm just going to bring a bit of texture into it. Remember, this does dry a fair amount lighter, so it is going to be quite pale. So I'll definitely be adding something to these windows, a little bit more texture, I think. I'm just going to stand up and look quickly.
Otherwise it's looking good. I'll do that. That I'll just add a little bit of color to it, but I'll have to wait for this to dry completely. That actually looks very nice. I quite like that. I wonder if I shouldn't. I'm actually looking at that. It actually looks very nice. I think I'm going to bring a little bit of that into this side as well. Just a hint. Sort of that old feel. I can just go back, well, just to give a hint of oldness. There we go. That works. Oh, that actually works quite well. And then I might just go back into these as well. So this window on this side, I think I might need a few more darks just to bring out those, that sort of texture there. And then here, definitely, I feel it's a little bit too plain. It almost looks like it's not quite finished, but then I was still putting the colours in on the edges. So where the cracks in that are, I can't just leave it black, because it will be a darker brown or a darker yellow. Okay, so I'll definitely bring a little bit of color into these little corners and that over here. But that's it, yeah. But I think that's it for the moment, guys. I can't really do much more until things start drying out. Yeah, okay. See you next time, let you know. Okay, cheers, bye.